Welcome to the sixth section on nutrition tools, and in this section we're covering food groups. You can see all the different food groups: fruits and vegetables, grains, meats, legumes and nuts, dairy, and oils. The reason the USDA divides foods into different groups is because they offer different nutrients. You can see that fruits offer vitamin A, C, potassium, and fiber. And vegetables offer pretty much the same, except for you're going to get some folate and magnesium as well. The vitamin A actually comes from the carotenoids and is then converted in the body to vitamin A. We'll learn more about this in the vitamin section. Grains provide a lot of B vitamins, and B vitamins are very important in carbohydrate metabolism. So it goes along with nature that they would naturally have B vitamins to help with metabolizing the carbohydrates that make up most of the grains. There's also iron, magnesium, and fiber. So the fruits, vegetables, and grains do provide a lot of fiber, as well as the legumes and nuts. You can see the fiber here. In addition, when we look to the meat, legumes, and nuts, this is where most of our protein foods are going to come from. Meat, of course, will also give iron, magnesium, a little bit of potassium, but zinc, and it very importantly, vitamin B12. Vitamin B12 only occurs in animal products. If you are a vegan, you have to supplement with vitamin B12 supplements or use a nutritional yeast. Legumes and nuts, you can see it's pretty similar to some of the nutrients that you'll get from meat and also from legumes and nuts. But in addition, with the legumes and nuts, there's fiber, also probably a little bit more potassium that's going to occur in meat, and then also some folate and vitamin A, particularly in nuts. Dairy is also a good source of protein. You're not going to get fiber in dairy products, so. We'll have vitamin B12, so remember vitamin B12 comes from animal products. Dairy is a very good source of calcium, and the reason that the USDA has used dairy as a food group is because it's one of the easiest and cheapest ways to obtain calcium in our diet. You don't have to eat dairy to obtain calcium, though, and we will go over this when we get to the mineral chapter. There's also some magnesium and potassium and riboflavin. Dairy is a very good source of riboflavin. This is a B vitamin. We'll go over this in the vitamins chapter. Now, vitamin A and D do not naturally occur in dairy products. They're usually fortified in dairy products. So in a lot of cheeses, you're not going to get these nutrients. Now, oils. Oils do have a lot of fat in them, but they do have some nutrients. In particular, some oils do have our essential fatty acids, in particular omega-3 fatty acids will occur in flaxseed oil. We'll have our monounsaturated fatty acids in olive oil. And we'll learn more about the fats in our lipid chapter. And oils are a very good source of vitamin E. Vitamin E is a fat-soluble vitamin, so you're going to find it in the foods with fat. So notice that it's in oils, but also in nuts. Before we get to our subdivisions of fruit and vegetable, I want to point out the difference between a fruit and vegetable. Now, a fruit is a plant which includes the seeds of that plant. But technically, a tomato is a fruit. An avocado is a fruit because we have the plant, and then you can see the seeds within that plant. So that's a very simplistic definition, but it's a very good one to use just as a guide. A vegetable is everything else, the remaining edible portions of that plant. So it could be a root. A root, as an example, is a carrot. It can be the leaves, such as the leafy green vegetables. Broccoli is actually a flower. So this is a flowering portion of that plant. So the fruit is the plant with the seeds inside, and the vegetable is pretty much everything else that is edible. Now, as we look, I do want you to know this definition of fruits versus vegetables, but for all intents and purposes, it doesn't really make that much of a difference. If you want to think of a tomato as a vegetable, that's fine as long as you understand why it is technically categorized as a fruit. The USDA divides foods, in particular fruits and vegetables, also into subgroups because of their nutrients. So if we look at the vegetable subgroups, you can see you want to eat a variety of vegetables because each category is offering you something different. The dark green have a lot of carotenoids in these. Not only is it a precursor to vitamin A in the body, we'll discuss this in vitamins, but also a phytochemical, phytonutrient, which we'll discuss later. And these are our antioxidants, or are fighters of carcinogens or things that cause cancer. So carotenoids are very occur in our dark green leafy vegetables, also potassium, vitamin C, and folate. The orange and deep yellow, again, a lot of carotenoids in the really bright colors, the orange and deep yellow. You can also see potassium and vitamin C. You can remember that folate occurs more in dark green leafy vegetables because folate is foliage, and foliage is, you know, you think of green trees and shrubs, so folate is more in dark green. Otherwise, the dark greens, orange and deep yellow, have fairly similar nutrients. So think of eating these bright colors and eating a lot of colors. If you can, you know, look at these colors I've shown here. And I wish I could have organized them to match, you know, the green with the dark green. But if you think about eating bright yellows and oranges and purples and greens, then you're going to get more nutrients. And I'm only listing one group of phytonutrients here, and we're going to cover that at the end of this chapter. But they're the greater variety of vegetables and fruits that you can eat, then and the more colors, then you're going to get more phytonutrients to fight off chronic diseases that we talked about, including cancer and heart disease. So legumes. Legumes are a vegetable, and they have folate, potassium, but also have iron and protein. And it's not that our other vegetables don't have any protein. They're just not a good source. So legumes, very good source of protein, but you're also getting these other nutrients as well. Starchy vegetables. We think of potatoes and carrots, and this would be potassium. Very high in potatoes, actually. And if you're eating purple potatoes, you're also getting a lot of phytonutrients, your cancer fighters. And then, of course, a good source of carbohydrates. A lot of us, we really need to reduce our starch consumption, but you should know that the starchy vegetables are offering you that. So starchy, this could include carrots, also are going to be a little bit more starchy, as well as and corn, and also particularly corn and potatoes. So looking at the food groups and your targets, you can see the grains, vegetables, and then the division of the vegetables, fruits, dairy, protein foods, and then oils. Notice that I like to look at beans and peas or legumes a little bit more with protein foods. Their nutrients are a little bit more similar, but they can go into either category. So with our grains, this is one thing I don't like about the USDA recommendations, or 2010 dietary guidelines. It's great that they're saying limit your refined grains, but when they say make half your grains whole grains, they really are saying it's okay as long as you stay to eat refined carbohydrates, as long as you stay under 3.5 ounces. Well, I don't think that's okay. I don't think that should be your goal. Your goal should be to eat mostly whole grains, not refined. Vegetable, really need an abundance. So in a variety, eat from the spectrum of colors and try something new. Go into your fruit and vegetable section and pick out a vegetable you've never eaten before and try to cook it and see what happens. Try something new every week. It's a good idea. Fruits, so whole fruits, they say no specific target. But really what they're saying is we look at 3 cups of vegetables, and remember, it should say servings here, but your dark leafy greens, really 2 cups is going to equal 1 serving. And even though we're looking at 5 servings of fruits and vegetables, remember how we talked about it, really it's 5 to 9. 9 is really the target. It's difficult, but 5 to 9 is really your serving. So these are absolute minimums. Now fruit juice, we'll talk a little bit later about why you really want to minimize your fruit juice. It's when you take out the fiber and you only have the sugar, it's a huge dose of fructose to your liver, and it can be damaging. So you don't want to consume a lot of fruit juices. Really limit your juice. Try to eat the whole fruit because you're going to need a lot of other nutrients with that, including the fiber. Dairy, if you're choosing dairy, you really want to go for more of the low-fat options. I'm not a fan of the non-fat because usually when they take out too much fat, they're putting something else in, generally sugar, and that's not good for you. Yogurt, remember, if you're going to eat yogurt, really a plain yogurt. It can be full fat, it can be low fat, but you don't want it flavored, because remember, flavored yogurts are like ice cream. And cheese. Cheese will actually can be a good source of calcium, but remember the serving size. 1.5 ounce is the 3 die. So if you think about a dice, 3 of those is just really 1 serving. It will give you some calcium, but there's usually a lot of sodium in there and a lot of saturated fat as well. Protein foods, seafood. Really, there's an emphasis or a push to eat more seafood. We'll talk a little bit about this in our controversy, because there are a lot of contaminants. There's a lot of lead and other contaminants from the ocean and fish. I don't recommend eating any farmed fish at all. They don't have as many nutrients and they have more saturated fat, fewer omega-3 fatty acids. But you know, wild fish, definitely, if you can eat that. And there is a push to try and eat 9 ounces, or at least twice a week if you can. If you, you know, are living in Humboldt County and you have access, you're going to have access to more fresh fish than most people, so you do have an advantage there. It is expensive though. Not everyone can afford to eat wild Alaskan salmon twice a week. So the meat and poultry, they say no specific target, and I do think this, you know, it really depends. You might be a vegetarian, or maybe you're aiming to more of a paleo style diet, or you're a bodybuilder. You might have a little bit higher protein needs. In general, anyway, if you look at about 6 ounces of our protein foods, you can substitute any of the meats with usually legumes, nuts, seeds, and soy products. Oils, the oils that I think are good to consume are olive oil, and I do like flaxseed oil. All of the other vegetable oils, especially the really refined vegetable oils, are generally not very good for you. If you're getting oil in a plastic squeeze bottle, it's highly refined. You're not going to get a lot of nutrients out of it. Make sure you're using that in a very limited amount.